Welcome to New Mexico Black Rifle Operators Union. I'm your host, Sean. Today, let's talk about injunctive relief. So what's going on with the pistol brace ban? So Mock v. Garland was, there's an injunction that the case Mock v. Garland came out. And with that, there is a chance that you could get some relief and not have to worry about the pistol brace until this case is finally heard. And they gave an option for you to do this. And how you do this is you become a Firearms Policy Coalition member. Now, I've become a Firearms Policy Coalition member a while back, and I did this because there are already these guys that are fighting. You know, I'm a member of GOA, Gun Owners of America. I'm a member of FPC. Used to be a member of the NRA, but the NRA is kind of useless when it comes to this type of thing. What happened in Mock v. Garland is the plaintiffs were relieved or given injunctive relief. What that means is that any household member of any of the plaintiffs is free from basically this case until it's finally heard out in court. Now, that goes to any one that has purchased anything from the named plaintiffs, which was, give me just a second. Maxim Defense Industries, LLC, was the brace vendor that was on this plaintiff case for Mock v. Garland, and any of the Firearms Policy Coalition members. Now, they left out in this brief as to when you had to be a Firearms Policy Coalition member, so there is that. Now, this was done in the Fifth Circuit judge case, which was in, they cover Texas, Louisiana, and I want to say Mississippi or something like that. But this case has already been tried, or not tried, but has already got an injunctive relief case going for them. So what that means is that the government, the ATF, if you're a member of one of these named plaintiffs, so you would have to either own a Maxim Defense Industry, be a brace, or be a family member of someone that has one, or you have to be a Firearms Policy Coalition member, and or any of their family. Now, what this does is that what has happened is it says that there's a preliminary set of judges that have looked at this and said, based on the merits of the case, they're probably going to win. That's good for us. But this is in the Fifth Circuit. You know, this is a Supreme Court circuit for those three states. Now, for the rest of us, I've looked into what that means. And what it basically means is that we're still covered because FPC can be in multiple states, even if we're not in their home state, and still be covered by their injunction. So we've got a temporary reprieve if you haven't already registered a firearm. Or possibly a temporary reprieve. Now, the judges in this case said that there was no carte blanche to give the entire country injunctive relief, so there's a very limited scope of who can get that injunctive relief. And you would have to be one of those members of FPC or one of those people that purchased a Maxim Defense brace. Now, what does that do for you in general? If you've registered your firearm as a short-barreled rifle and you still got the injunctive, you're covered by the injunctive relief, you're still in the hopper, you're still good. For the rest of us who may or may not have one of these, because not everybody in FPC, myself included, has a pistol brace. I had one, I got rid of the thing because I saw this coming down the pipe, and to be honest, I want a short-barreled rifle. I'm going to SBR my MP5 eventually. I still haven't. I've still got the cap on it to make it an MP5. It's a ZF5. And the AR I had, I just turned into a regular 20-inch barreled rifle because I've been looking at making a clone of one of the original, you know, A4s flat tops so I could, you know, put optics on it still, but get the 20-inch advantage that comes with a longer barreled rifle. Now, this is cool that this has happened, but it's kind of sad that we're in this phase that we're having to seek injunctive relief for oppression that the federal government's pushing down on us. Now, that doesn't mean to be a turd. That's how this would have been enforced anyway. The chances that the federal government went door-to-door to look for these things, pretty slim. The chances that the list of who are FPC members gets released is very slim also, because there's such a thing as you cannot exercise a right, or they cannot enforce something if you're exercising one of your other rights. So there's two rights here that they would have to worry about. FPC's First Amendment right, which means that they have the right to withhold that name list from the ATF or from the federal government. That's one. And two, that you being a member and exercising your Second Amendment right and your First Amendment right means that they can't nail you for this part of the injunction. It's really complicated, and I hope I'm getting this message out correctly. I'm not a legal scholar, and don't take anything I'm saying as legal advice. Do your own research and check it out. But go to FPC.com or firearmspolicy.org and check out what they have, because they're marketing very heavily right now to get as many members as they can, and you should be a member. Firearms Policy Coalition is not the NRA. These guys have basically been in the dirt for every 2A thing that can possibly be going on. They deserve our support, and that's why I have been a member for a while now. And Gun Owners of America is the same vein. These guys are the ones, what this money goes to when you join a membership or get a membership, and their membership is only like $30. What happens when you become a member is it adds the money to their coffers so that they can carry on these cases in our name. You know, the stuff that the NRA was supposed to do, instead bought, suits for Wayne LaPierre, the FUD guys that all support the NRA and their ILA group and say that they're all so great. No, they're not. FPC and GOA are the ones that are actually the real deal. All these winning cases that we keep seeing, the bump stock ban, both cases that have won were either by one organization or the other. So these guys are in the fight for us, and they deserve our backing. You know, they're actually getting out there and doing this. And yeah, it's $30, but guess what? That's $30 that they use to fight these battles that we can't do ourselves, that we need legal help and legal recourse for. If you also haven't heard, there's an interesting wrinkle in the GOA case. The district attorney, or give me a sec, let me find. The Attorney General of Texas, AG Ken Paxton, has been impeached by their House for something. It's not a big deal for us. If you're not living in Texas, it's a big deal. They haven't pushed it through the Senate. So that may have some reflection on the other case that GOA is involved. And that one affects 26 different states, more of the right-leaning states that actually signed on with his case against this unjust ban. Now, with the debt ceiling settlement, there's a potential that Congress does something in our favor. But after seeing what they did in the debt ceiling negotiations, I'm not holding too much water in that for myself, because it looks like Kevin McCarthy basically caved to whatever the left wanted, and the only thing we're getting out of this is a little bit of relief when it comes to the IRS. Maybe they won't get their 87,000 agents to come enforce unjust tax laws on American citizens, because that's what it would be used for. They wouldn't be coming after big corporations. They'd be coming after you and I. And that's what's disheartening about some of this stuff, you know. We see it all the time, or I see it all the time, and I wonder, what are they doing for the little guy? You know, the guy that's just trying to keep his head above water, to work every day, to keep his business going, and staying out of, you know, this political culture war stuff. Well, this is how you stay out of that culture war crap, but still make your voice heard, is by joining something like FPC or joining something like GOA. Because these guys are taking them to the mat, you know. A big win in the Fifth Circuit or any other circuit, but, you know, where I'm at, is going to have national ripples that will cause case precedent, so that if you ever do have to go to court, that you have that as a weapon in your toolbox to fight these unjust lawsuits that are coming down, not lawsuits, but these unjust cases coming down on you. You know, it would make more sense in New Mexico specifically that they focused on crime and the bail reforms that they've did that has turned the New Mexico court case system or the court system into a revolving door for criminals. You know, we're not to the stages of California. I have a friend who said she wasn't coming to New Mexico. She was a former New Mexico resident because of our crime. And I'm wondering if I'm getting desensitized to it, but I'm pretty sure I'm not. New Mexico is nowhere near where California, New York, where they're running through stores and stealing stuff. It is bad in larger cities. Albuquerque, they're having some of those problems like what you see in California starting to manifest there. And we are seeing a larger fentanyl problem here. But as far as the actual crime in like small town New Mexico, yeah, we're seeing more of it. I'm seeing more of it. Again, we've had another mass shooting in northwest New Mexico. I still attribute a lot of this to just pure mental health. You know, you cannot, I've said this multiple times on this podcast specifically, you cannot lock down an entire country for damn near 3 years without repercussions. People have lost their mind. You know, I find myself even at times being edgy and nervous being out in public where that wasn't the case just a few years ago. And I think it's because I'm having to reacclimate myself to being in public. And there's a lot of people that are doing the same thing. You know, we, for 3 years in New Mexico, no joke, 3 years, we were locked down. You know, the 15 days to slow the spread was extended in New Mexico because of our awesome governor. And I'm saying that ironically and very tongue-in-cheek. She's not an awesome governor. She held counties hostage to get their vaccination rates up despite infection rates to try to get them to open up so they could conduct normal business. You know, I was one of those idiots that took the vaccines, the two rounds, the first rounds, because I was hoping that it would help San Juan County, the county I live in, get past the vaccination rate and get us to the point where we could open back up and do normal things in life again. Do I regret it? Absolutely. I injected myself with, or I didn't inject myself, that they did, injected me with something that I consider totally experimental. I've not had any repercussions from that myself, but again, that's a sample size of one. I can't say anything for anybody else. I didn't have any vaccine injuries. The worst I got was a sore arm, and I slept for part of a day. But I still got COVID after my second shot. So it did nothing to prevent me from getting COVID, the actual variant. You know, I got the Omicron variant, which was a week of my life that it was taken offline. I would tell you it was probably one of the worst cases of something similar to the flu I've ever had. My body ached. It was not a pleasant experience. I had a fever for multiple days. So they're not saying COVID wasn't without some fear, but it was no near the case of destroying your life if you got it. You know, and I'm one of those people that's on the cusp of, you know, I'm a heavy guy, so I'm overweight, but I'm working on that, and which makes me close to being a diabetic also. So I have to be very careful about my diet and what I'm doing, because I am improving myself, and I'm not doing it because of COVID. I'm doing it because it's time. You know, I'm 45 years old. It's time to get off my duff. It's time to start being more active. I've started doing my version of the sunny drill. I'm up to 18 push-ups and 40 meters, 45 meters of dead run. And then I can engage targets, and I'm still hitting the targets, which means if I pushed myself a little harder, I probably would do even better and get the full point of what I'm trying to do. My goal is to do 25 push-ups and to run 75 meters, and then engage all the series of targets I have and be effective at doing it. Now, I'm doing this again for myself. This is me reconnecting my mind, my body, and my soul together in a state that I, you know, firearms excite me. You know, this type of tactical training is something that is very much in my wheelhouse. It's something I enjoy doing. So this is my way of hitting the gym in a weird way. You know, hitting the gym, gyms don't excite me. I have all the equipment I need at my house to do what I need to do for my exercise, and it's time I used it, you know. But to get back to the injunction, we have a little bit of breathing room if you're a Firearms Policy Coalition member, and I hope we get to enjoy that, and I hope this case gets turned around. Like, share, subscribe, be great. My politics are rather controversial. Who would have thought that I ain't catching all slack? And I have enemies on my ball sack. I'm thinking insanity's what you call it, and I just get a